Very good day, friends. We will go ahead with the revision of this topic, Higher Purchase and Installment System. Now, this topic, as such, if you see from the past test, has not been tested much over the last 2-3 years. But if tested once, I think one attempt it has come, which has been a 10-mark question. So if it comes, it comes in a 10-mark question. But though not frequently tested, there is still a potential for being tested, and again, scoring chapter. Right? So let's straight away get into the topic. Now, what is higher purchase? Purchase of an asset or purchase of any item, okay, predominantly a fixed asset, without payment of the entire consideration. So the consideration is agreed to be paid over installments. So what happens is, when you pay the installments, we are going to have interest on the installment, on the amount of the consideration. So if you are going to have the total value of the asset as 1 lakh spread over 5 installments, you will not be paying 1 lakh by 5, which is 20,000 rupees. You will be paying some amount which is inclusive of interest. Okay. So there are two terms that you have to remember. One is the cash price, okay, which is the cost of purchase of the asset. And the other is called as the higher purchase price, which is basically cash price plus interest component. Okay, now how is this interest calculated? Friends, this interest is not going to be calculated on a lump sum amount. We have to understand that this is an outflow, periodic outflow or periodic payment. So interest is also calculated on a diminishing balance method. So interest will be calculated on the remaining principal after the installment is being paid. So to calculate interest, we will generally use a table by which we arrive at the interest, or we use the annuity method, right? So from this area of calculation of interest, let us quickly understand how we need to calculate the cash price given the higher purchase price. Okay, so if suppose a machine was brought, okay, as 3 years installments with installment amount as 25,000 per annum at the rate of 10%. Let us assume at the rate of 10% per annum. So interest at the rate of 10% per annum. Okay. Down payment, which is the initial payment that is made at the time of purchasing the asset. So down payment amounted to rupees 10,000. Calculate cash price and interest. So a quick table. Friends, there are two methods. First, let me show the table method, which can be used when the installments are equal or unequal. Whichever way it is, you can use that particular method. So in these cases, when you have to calculate the higher purchase, when you have to calculate the cash price from the higher purchase price, we generally go by the reverse method. So why we are adopting the reverse method? We are back working, saying that after including the interest, if this is the balance, then what will be the amount without interest? So that back working we are going to do. So hence we start from year 3. Now, in the last year, what would be the amount of installment or the amount that is payable? The amount that will be payable will be 25,000. Installment is 25,000 per annum, so amount payable is 25,000. Okay, now this 25,000 includes the interest. So 25,000 into 10 by 110, which will give you 2273. So I'm just rounding off 2273. And therefore, what will be the principal? This 20,000 includes an interest of 2273. So the principal will be 25,000 minus 2273, which is 22,727. Right? Okay. Now, when you come to the second year, okay, when you come to the second year, please listen carefully. The second year, we are going to pay an installment amount of 25,000, which ideally includes the interest. Okay. And ideally, when you are in the second year, you wouldn't have paid the third year balance also. You wouldn't have paid the third year installment. So, which means the third year's principal would have been due. On which, so basically this 22,727 is due, on which the interest has been charged at 2273 rupees. That is why you are pending up paying an amount of 25,000 rupees. Right. So effectively what it means, in the year 2, I not only have my year 2's amount pending, I also have the principal to be paid in year 3 that is pending, which is 22,727. So the balance will be 22,727 plus second year's installment, which is 25,000. Right. So this together would have been pending. Right. Now this together includes the interest amount. So interest will be 25,000 plus 22,727. So 47,727. Okay, 47,727 is the amount which is including interest. So I am going to say into 10 by 110. 47,727 is the amount for second and third year together, including the interest. So which gives us the calculation of principal. So what is the principal amount? The interest amount. Interest is going to be 47,727 into 10 by 110, which is 4,339. Now, what is the principal? Okay. Now, here, the principal will be, okay, listen very carefully. The principal will be principal that is pertaining to year 2 alone. Okay. In other words, the total balance is how much? 47,727 minus interest 4,339, which gives you the amount 43,388. Now, out of this 43,388, 22,727 is the principal for the next year. So, what is the principal portion that is getting repaid in the second year? The principal portion that is getting repaid in the second year amounts to 20,661. So, when I am paying the 25,000 installment in the second year, I am actually paying a principal portion of 20,661 plus interest of 4,339. Right? Now, in the same manner, I calculate for year 1. Now, in year 1, year 2 principal would have been due, year 3's principal would have also been due, and that apart would have also been due for the installment of the first year. So, 22,727 plus 20,661 plus 25,000, which will give you 68,388 into 10 by 110. We are calculating year-on-year interest only. Okay, so that is why I am not multiplying it by a number of years. I am only taking as year-on-year interest. Right? So, into 10 by 110 will give you 6,217. And therefore, the principal portion is going to be for year 1. Again, I can take 68,388 minus 6,217 minus principal of these 2 years. Or in other words, I can simply do it as 25,000, which is the installment amount, minus interest amount. So 25,000 installment amount minus 6,217, which gives me 18,783. So if you see, always in the initial years, your interest payout will be more, and in the later years, your interest payout will be less and principal payout will be more. So in the initial years, if you see, the principal is less, interest is more, but going later, principal becomes higher and interest becomes lesser. So the total interest that we are going to pay over the 3 years is going to be 12,829, and the total principal is 22,727 plus 20,661 plus 18,783, 62,171, add down payment, because to the extent of down payment made, no interest would have been paid because you are paying the entire down payment amount in the first day itself. So he is not going to charge you any amount on the any interest on the down payment. However, it is also a consideration paid. So add down payment 10,000, which gives you a total cash price of 72,171. Okay, so this is a method that you will be calculating the cash price given the installment amount and the rate of interest. Friends, this method will be helpful whether the installment amount is same or whether the installment amount is different. If they say installment 1 is 2,000, installment 2 is 4,000, installment 3 is 6,000, any amount they give, this method is going to be helpful, right? If the installments are same, you can also use the annuity method. So if they are equal installments, you can also use the annuity method to find out which will be, I can show you under annuity method, which is only if installment is the same. Okay, so if installments are equal, then what will be the formula that we can take here is, okay, cash price is equal to down payment plus installment amount divided by present value annuity factor for 10% for 3 years. So down payment is 10,000 rupees plus installment amount is 25,000. Okay, annual installment by 25,000 divided by present value annuity factor for 10 years, for 10%. So 1 divided by 1.1. 1 divided by, so divided 1 divided by 1, 1 divided by 1.1, the whole cube, which is for 3 years, third year. Okay. Plus, again, 1 divided by 1.1, the whole square. Plus, 1 divided by 1.1 the whole power 1. So basically, if it is for 3 years, I am going to take 1 divided by the rate, 1 plus rate of interest. So 10% is 1 divided by 1 plus 0.10. Okay, if it is 20%, 1 divided by 1 plus 0.20, like that. Okay, so let me also write that. One divided by one plus rate of interest. Okay, the whole power n. So For each year, it is whole power n. Third year, power 3. Second year, power 2. First year, power 1. But we are doing an annuity factor, so we need to add all the values. So that gives you... Yes, friends? Sorry, I wrote it as... Instead of... Actually, it is multiplication. I wrote it as division by mistake. Okay, so it is down payment plus installment into present value annuity factor. Okay, by mistake I wrote it as divided, so it is into. Okay, so you will be getting your answer as same 10,000 plus 25,000 into 2.4868 or 69. Which will give you approximately the same value, 62,172. So plus 10,000, so which gives you 72,172. Same amount, 1 or 2 rupees here and there because of decimal approximations. Okay, so friends, you can either use the table method or you can use the annuity method. Annuity method can be used only when the installments are equal. But most of your questions, they may not mention equal installments. So prefer to go by the table method. If it is the annuity method, the formula is very simple. Down payment plus installment into present value annuity factor. Right? So this gives you the calculation of cash price given the higher purchase price or given the installment price. Okay. This can be tested as a separate question or for any of your accounting based questions, this can be the base, one of the working notes that you may have to do. Okay. They can otherwise also test you on the opposite direction, like calculate a higher purchase price given the cash price. Okay. That can also be done. That is forward working, where you are going to add the interest for each year to find out the higher purchase price. Right, friends? Okay, but that has not been predominantly tested. What has been predominantly tested is this. So, I am quickly running through this method alone for the revision. Right, friends? Okay, so this is part one, calculation of cash price and interest. Now, moving on to the accounting entries. If you are clear with the accounting entries, then higher purchase is done. Because predominantly they ask you to prepare the ledger accounts for which accounting entries are going to be forming your basics. Right? So we are going to see the accounting entries first in the books of higher purchaser. So the person who purchases. Ideally, you can account it in two methods. One is the cash basis and the other is the interest suspense basis. But interest suspense basis is not required to be followed. In the exams, they also have not mentioned so far that you have to follow this method only or that method only. So let us learn or quickly brush through the journal entries, basic journal entries for cash basis, okay, which will also be the basis on which you are going to prepare the ledger. If you change the method, ma'am, will my answer change? No, nothing is going to change. Okay, so cash basis is going to be the most tested area, has been the most tested area rather. Okay, so I am going to go by a quick revision of the journal entries under cash basis. So what is the first transaction? Purchase of the asset. Journal entry. Asset account debit. 2. Hire vendor account at cash price. So the transaction has to be recorded at cost or at the cash price. Second, payment of down payment. So you're going to pay the hire vendor. Hire vendor account debit to cash or bank. So two bank account. Right? Third, interest due every year. So under this method, what we are going to do? We are going to record the interest that is due year on year. We are going to record the accrual year on year. For instance, going by the previous example, we will take first year interest as 6217, second year interest as 4339, and third year interest as 2273. Interest will be taken only according to this proportion. Okay, so calculation of this table is going to be important. Right? So interest calculation. So going by the interest entry, so this interest is an expense in the books of the higher purchaser. So interest account debit to higher vendor, because you have recorded the liability only at cash price, whereas this interest is also payable to the higher vendor. So I am recording it as a liability to the higher vendor. Next, payment of installment. Payment of installment. Now, in case of payment of the installment, what will happen? Higher vendor account debit to cash or bank. So, to bank account. Higher vendor account debit to bank account. So this is for payment of installment, right? So what will happen at the end of the year? Interest will get transferred. So okay, before that, asset is eligible for depreciation. So depreciation on the asset. Depreciation account debit to asset account. Depreciation account debit to asset account. Now, transfer entry at the end of the year. Now, we have two transfer entries, friends. One is for the interest expense and the second is for the depreciation. So, what is the first transfer entry for interest expense? P&L account debit to interest. And for depreciation again, P&L account debit to depreciation. Okay. So, these are the quick summary of the entries in the books of the higher purchaser. Right? If you remember these entries, they are more than enough for you to prepare the ledger account. Right? I am not yet done with the books of the higher purchaser yet. The most important part in case of repossession, which means where there is a failure of payment of installment and the asset is being taken back by the vendor. Asset is being taken back by the seller. So what happens? The asset has to be reduced in the books. At what price? Okay. Please understand. The asset will be removed from the books at written down value or value calculated by the vendor. Okay, not based on the value calculated by the purchaser. Okay, it is by the vendor or otherwise the seller. Okay, it will be the written down value or the value calculated by the seller. Written down value is not the value of the purchaser. Written down value is just the other word here used for the value calculated by the seller. So you can just remember it as, if you are charging depreciation in your books, no problem, that's your books. But for the purpose of repossession, the value of the asset to be repossessed. Okay, the value will be calculated at the value that is given by the seller, okay, or at the rate of depreciation or write-off provided by the seller, right? This value is what is called as the repossession value or repossessed value. Okay, so what will be the journal entry? The journal entry will be hire vendor account debit to asset account. Hire vendor account debit to asset account. Okay, you would have already charged depreciation. Now you are reversing the asset by cancelling your liability against the hire vendor, because the asset is being taken back by the hire vendor. Okay, remember, before this entry itself, interest, depreciation would have been already charged. Up to the accrual date. So, whatever is the eligible interest, okay, or whatever is the interest amount to be charged, whatever is the depreciation till the date of repossession or till the given date, everything will be charged in the given case. Okay, so up to the date, right? So, after that only repossession is going to take place. Now, if there is a difference between the written down value of the asset repossessed in the books of purchaser and the repossession value, so what does this imply? Suppose I am charging depreciation at 20%, but the repossession he has taken assuming say 25% depreciation or 25% write-off. So there will naturally be a difference between the value in my books and the value at which the asset has been repossessed. Okay, right, there will naturally be a difference. That difference has to be taken to P&L account. The difference has to be taken to P&L account. Okay, so basically, if it is a loss, then the entry will be P&L account debit to asset account. Or if it is a gain, the entry will be asset account debit to P&L account. Okay, whichever is the case will apply, right? Okay, and subsequently, if you are settling any balance amount to the hire vendor, then you will naturally pass the entry as hire vendor account debit to bank account if there is a settlement or if there is any payment. So for any settlement, the journal entry is going to be hire vendor account debit to bank account. So what happens here? Okay, you are just preparing an asset entering into the books depreciated, then the asset is being removed if it is a repossession. Okay, the most important point to here to remember is the valuation of the repossessed asset. It will be valued at what rate? At the value calculated by the vendor. Okay, and whatever is the difference between that value and the value in your books, that will be taken to P&L account. If you remember these two points, then done. Then hire purchase is a simple game. right? So this summarizes your entries on the books of the higher purchaser. Right, friends? Now we are moving on to the same set of entries from the books of the higher vendor. Okay. For the higher vendor, this is a sale. So this is effectively a sale in the normal course of business. So let's start writing first. At the time of sale, it is like sales account debit to, debtors account debit to sale. So here we will write higher purchaser account debit, name of the higher purchaser, whoever it is, debit to higher purchase sale, to higher purchase sales account. Okay, to higher purchase sales account. Next, down payment. The higher vendor is receiving down payment. What will be the entry? Bank account debit to higher purchaser. Right? Next. Interest. This interest is not going to change because interest is calculated based on the cost of funds. So that interest you would have already calculated in the cash price table. So interest accrual. Now this interest is an interest income in the books of the higher vendor. So what will be the entry? Higher purchaser account debit to interest account. Higher purchaser account debit to interest account. Now for payment of installment, entry is going to be same. Bank account debit to higher purchaser. Bank account debit to higher purchaser. Now this is a sale in the ordinary course of business. So now this higher vendor has earned two types of revenue. One, sale revenue, and two, interest. Now remember, the sale entry that you are passing first will be at perfect cash price. Will be at cash price. Okay. So you can ask how the profit will come. That cash price will already include the profit. This interest is only for the delayed payment. Interest is not profit. Interest is only the time factor. Right, so this cash price amounts for the selling price. Right, so now when you finally do the transfer entry, okay, first sales will get transferred to trading account. So we will say higher purchase sales account debit to trading account because it is business transaction. And similarly, interest income will get transferred to P&L account. Interest account debit to P&L account. Right? So these are the transactions in the books of the higher vendor. Again, in the books of the higher vendor also, there is a method called as interest suspense. But most of your questions are not focusing on that method. So we are not following, we are not practicing that method for revision purposes. Okay. If they are asking you to prepare the ledger, you might as well prepare under this method directly. Okay. So the most commonly or widely tested method is going to be this. So you can directly go ahead under this method itself. Right. Now coming to repossession scenario. Okay. In case of repossession, Now, what happens in case of repossession? The repossessed value is calculated, correct, by the vendor. That value only you will be taking in the books of the hire purchaser also. So, repossessed value is calculated by the vendor or by the seller. Okay. Now, how do we record this transaction? These goods are coming back, but not in the form of sales return as such, but these are specific repossessions. So, we are going to take it as to a separate account called as goods repossessed account debit to hire purchaser account. Goods repossessed account debit to hire purchaser account. Right? Goods repossessed to hire purchaser. This will be at the repossession value. Okay. Now, once the goods are repossessed, the seller will not retain it as it is. He will try to probably incur some additional maintenance expenses and sell off the asset, sell off this particular goods again, because he wants a rotation of his funds. So, what he will do is additional expenses on repair, etc. So, if it is additional expenses, then it is going to be goods repossessed account debit to bank account, cash or bank account, and he will try to sell this goods, okay, sale of repossessed goods. So, when he is going to sell, very simple, bank account debit, okay, to goods repossessed account. He will try to sell it at a profit. So, to profit and loss account. If it is a loss, then profit and loss account will get debited. So, this will become a resale kind of a transaction. So, bank account debit to goods repossessed to profit and loss account. So, with that, your transactions will get over. And if any further settlement received from hire purchaser, then the entry is going to be very simple. Bank account debit to hire purchaser. Right? So, this summarizes your entries in the books of the hire vendor or the seller. Friends, whether it is complete repossession, which is if you are selling 5 items and the entire 5 items are going to be repossessed, or whether it is partial repossession, where I am selling 5 items and I am taking back only 2 items. Okay, so whether it is complete repossession or partial repossession, the journal entries, the calculation all remains the same. Okay, so the only change that you have to remember is, okay, in case of complete or partial repossession, okay, no difference in treatment in the books of seller or otherwise hire vendor. instead of calculating for five assets, you will calculate for two assets, or calculating for two assets, you are going to calculate for five assets. So effectively, the treatment in the books of the seller or the hire vendor is not going to change. But remember, in the books of hire purchaser, okay, or the buyer, right? If there is a complete repossession, then book value of asset after repossession should be zero. Basically, I am giving away the entire asset. So, the entire asset will be written off. Okay. And whatever is the remaining written down value in the books, you have to make it zero. So, book value in the asset after repossession should become zero. So, balance, that is balance carried down in asset account is nil. It is complete repossession. Whereas, if there is a partial repossession, the asset value will still be there. For what? To the extent of the assets that are remaining with you. Okay? The book value of assets remaining with the buyer will be retained. That is, balance carried down will be, okay, asset cost, which is cash price, for the remaining assets. Say if you are going to have five assets, out of which two are repossessed. So how many are left? Three. So asset cost for the remaining assets minus depreciation on the remaining assets, on these assets. Otherwise, I can call this together as written down value of the remaining three assets. So the balance carried down will be asset cost for the remaining assets minus depreciation on these three assets. So that value should be the closing balance. Okay. And according to that, you should be able to close your ledger account for the asset that is repossessed. So what will happen when there is a repossession? Okay. You should always remember, first to check what is the repossession. Is it full repossession or complete repossession or partial repossession? Accordingly, determine what will be the closing balance of the asset. Calculate the repossession value and the difference in the books in the asset account. Okay, so what will happen is the difference or the balancing figure in the asset account will be the loss on account of repossession, or the balancing figure on account of repossession, which will be taken to P&L account. Like I said, the difference between the repossession value and the written down value in the books, that difference which will be taken to P&L account, right? So that will be your balancing figure. So effectively, if you see, when you prepare the ledger account, this amount that you calculate, the difference between written down value of the assets repossessed in the books of the purchaser and repossession value, this will be the balancing figure in asset account. Okay, so you can either arrive at this as balancing figure, or you can do this and arrive the closing balance of the asset as balancing figure, or you can calculate both and check your answers. Any which ways, your answer is going to work fine. Okay, so remember only one rule: your closing balance of the asset should be there as the written down value of the remaining assets when it is a partial repossession, and the balancing figure is what will be taken to P&L account. Right? Okay, friends. So this is a nutshell summary of hire purchase transactions in the books of hire purchaser and hire vendor. Okay, if you are remembering these journal entries, then preparation of ledger is going to be very, very, very easy. Okay, right, friends. And again, calculation of cash price is going to be critical, which has been predominantly also being tested when there are questions on hire purchase. Right. So if you look at the past tax questions, in May of the last four attempts, in May 2019 alone, there was a question based on partial repossession for 10 marks. Let's look at that question. Okay. Amar bought six scooters from Mrs. Banu on 1st April 2015 on the following terms. Down payment 3 lakh. First installment 1,59,000. Second installment 1,47,000. Third installment 1,65,000. Interest is charged at 6% per annum. 10% per annum. Amar provides depreciation at 20% on diminishing balance method. So this is in the books of Amar. On 31st March 2018, Amar failed to pay the third installment, upon which Banu repossessed two scooters. How many scooters were bought? Six were bought, out of which two were repossessed. Banu agreed to leave the other four scooters with Amar and adjusted the value of repossessed scooters against the amount due. Okay, so the amount of repossessed scooters were adjusted. The scooters were taken over, valued on the basis of 30% depreciation per annum. Amar provides 20%, but that is not required for us. For us, what is important? 30% depreciation per annum is the value on which the repossession is done. The balance remaining amount on the vendor's account after the adjustment was paid after 5 months with interest at 15% per annum. Banu incurred repair expenses on repossessed scooters and sold it for 1,05,000. Calculate cash price with interest. Prepare scooter account and Banu account in the books of Amar. So you are going to prepare the asset account and the hire vendor account in the books of Amar. And you are going to prepare the goods repossessed account in the books of Banu, which is the hire vendor. Right? So, quickly, let's calculate the cash price and let us run through the entries. Friends, you should be getting a working of 6,90,000 as the cash price for six scooters together. So, price per scooter will be 6,90,000 divided by 6. 1,15,000. Okay, so you can take it as 6,90,000 in total. So now I am going to the ledger of scooters or the asset account. So first, asset account debit to Banu's account, 6,90,000. By depreciation at 20%, 1,38,000. I have prepared the ledger. You can check the answers. Okay, by depreciation 1,38,000. Similarly, for the second year, okay, so you are breaking the balance down for the second year, and in the second year it is again by depreciation for written down on written down value basis. So at 20% on 5,52,000. So 20% into 5,52,000 will give you 1,10,400, which is closing balance of 4,41,600. Okay. Again, in the third year, first charge the depreciation on the asset. Okay. Now, the depreciation on the asset is going to be 4,41,600 into 20%, which is 88,320. 4,41,600 into 20%, 88,320. Okay. Now, let us calculate the value of repossession. So how do we calculate the value of repossession? The question mentions that the value of repossessed scooters were taken on the basis of 30% depreciation per annum. So on return on value basis for how many years? 3 years. So let us calculate the repossession value. How do we calculate? Okay, let us take a simple understanding. It is going to be 6 lakh. So I'm showing the workings here, friends, for your understanding. 6,90,000 is the cash price for 6 scooters. So what will be the cash price for 2 scooters into 2 by 6? Which will give you 2,30,000. Okay. Now on 2,30,000 cash price, 3 years depreciation at written down value at what percentage? 30% has to be computed. Please compute. So 2,30,000 into 30% for first year, which will give you 69,000 minus 1,61,000. So 1,61,000 into 30% 48,300 minus, again we are going to compute, 2,30,000 minus 69,000 minus 48,300, which will give you 1,12,700 into 30%. So 33,810. So which will give you 78,890. So the value of the scooters repossessed will be 78,890. Friends, we can now do two ways. You can calculate the closing balance. Okay, then find out the balancing figure of the values. Or you can also do, I will find out the loss on repossession and hence calculate the balancing figure. Whichever way you do, your answer is going to remain the same. Okay, so let us calculate the loss on repossession. So profit or loss on repossession. Okay. Now let's check. Okay, what is the written down value of the two scooters in the books of Amar? In the books of Amar, we have to take 20% depreciation. So I will take it as 2,30,000, which is the cost of the two scooters, minus 20% depreciation on written down value for 3 years. So first year it will be 46,000. Second year it is going to be 36,800. And third year it's going to be 29,440. So which will give you the value of 117,760. So this is the written down value as per books of repossessed asset. So now what will be the profit or loss? How to find it out? Okay, simple. What is your written down value? 1,17,000, which you have given it back at 78,000. So effectively, are you incurring a profit or a loss? This is like, assume it like a sale of asset. Your book value is more, the value at which you have given is less. So it is a loss. So remember, W, written down value, is greater than repossessed value. It means a loss. And if written down value is less than repossessed value, generally it will be a loss only, friends. It cannot be a gain. Okay, but let's write it as a formula. It is a profit. So here loss is going to be 117,760 minus 78,890, which will give you 38,870. So this is the loss on repossession. Okay, loss on repossession. Now how to calculate the closing balance of asset? Closing balance of asset account. Now to calculate it, very simple, we are going to do the same method, but here we are going to do it for the assets which are retained. So we are going to do, I have how many assets in hand? I have 4 scooters in hand. So 6,90,000 into 4 by 6, which is the cost of 4 scooters, minus depreciation at 20% for 3 years. So minus 3 years depreciation. Which will give you, calculate, let's calculate the amount directly. I hope you are getting this number, friends. Right? So if you actually prepare the asset account, now let's go and continue with the asset account. Okay. Now in the asset account, buy Bhanu account for repossession 78,890. Buy profit and loss account. Because if it is a loss, I have to write profit and loss account debit to asset account. So, buy profit and loss account 38,870 and buy balance carry down 235,520. Friends, you can calculate all the three as an answer also. Okay, you will get the same exact answers. Else, you can do two of them and calculate the balance as the balancing figure. Or you can do balance carried down and value taken over. Value taken over and balance carried down, you can find out, and you can do profit or loss as balancing figure. Here, I have taken profit or loss as balancing figure. Okay, but you can still do, go ahead and do the workings. You will get the same answer, or you can also use them for cross verification. So this is the logic behind calculation of repossessed value, loss on repossession, and the closing balance of the asset account. Right? Yes. So this gives you the scooters account. I hope you can directly prepare the higher vendor account. So now I am going to the goods repossessed account. Now going to the goods repossessed account, Amar account. So goods repossessed account debit to Amar account in the books of the higher vendor 78,890. Additional repair, 2 repair 15,000. Buy bank for sale 1,05,000. And 2 profit and loss account for profit 11,110. Here, I have ensured that we have carried down the balances because the transaction, let's read the transaction once. The question says that Banu incurred the expenses and sold it on 25th April, whereas repossession happened on 31st of March, which are spreading across two financial years. So that is why I have ensured to give the breakup in the ledger account. Okay, so this is the goods repossessed account. Right, friends? Okay, so simple, direct question, okay? And it is going to be a very, very easy calculation, scorable area if you are going to get it for 5 or 10 marks. Right, friends? Okay, this was the only question in the last 2 years that has been tested so far in your new syllabus. Okay, now going on to the question in your November 2020 RTP, just to give an idea of what question it is. Of course, you can try the question and the answers, it is all the same pattern of questioning, friends. The answers to the previous question, your past asked of all previous RTPs and 2020 RTP, which was also part of November 18, May 19 RTP also. So all these RTPs had the same question, same. I literally mean it, the same question. Okay, so the answers are also given to you. You can verify them with your practice, right? So let's quickly run through the question. X purchased 3 cars from Y on hire purchase basis, the cash price being 2 lakh. So the cash price is given in the question. The hire purchaser charged depreciation on diminishing balance. 2 cars were seized by the hire vendor when the second installment was not paid at the end of the second year. The hire vendor valued the 2 cars at cash price less 30% depreciation charged under diminishing balance method. The hire vendors spent 10,000 on repairs of the car and then sold for an amount of 1,70,000. You are required to compute agreed value of the 2 cars taken back. So what, which is nothing but the repossessed value. How to calculate repossessed value? Cash price minus depreciation as agreed by the hire vendor, calculated by the hire vendor. Okay, not by the hire purchaser, but by the hire vendor. Next, book value of the car of the hire purchaser. So balance carried down. Profit or loss of hire purchase taken back by the hire vendor. So profit or loss on repossession. And profit or loss of the hire of the cars repossessed when sold by the hire vendor. So this is nothing but profit or loss on sale of repossessed goods, which is the profit or loss that you got in which account? Goods repossessed account. So here they are not even asking you to take the effort of calculating the cash price. Cash price is directly given to you, my dear friends. You just need to do the 3 calculations that we did, working notes. What is? So that is calculation of repossession value, calculation of closing balance of the asset account, calculation of loss or gain on repossession. And then you can do the goods repossessed loss or gain from the hire vendor's perspective. So, point 1, 2 and 3 will be from the hire purchaser. Okay. And point 4 is going to be from the hire vendor perspective. Same pattern question. It is just a matter of calculation. Right. The solutions are given to you, will be given to you as a part of your notes. So, you can go through them in your practice sessions, right? So please ensure to practice the questions. It is a cakewalk chapter, very, very, very easily scorable chapter if asked, right, friends? So this summarizes our revision on hire purchase. Again, simple yet scorable chapter. So please ensure you are mastering over the chapters, right? Thank you.